What do glaciers, diamonds, and liquid nitrogen have in common? Well, aside from just looking really awesome, these things are all made out of substances that are absolutely necessary for life to exist on Earth. Well, you're probably thinking, but Anthony, living things aren't made out of diamonds. And that might be true, but the ingredients to create diamonds exists within all of us. In today's lesson, we'll be unpacking these life-giving resources as we define ecosystems and explain how they are impacted by the water, carbon, and nitrogen cycles. Let's get into it! In our last lesson, we introduced the biosphere, which is the part of the Earth where all life exists. Within the biosphere, there are regions called biomes with distinct climates. And if we zoom in just a little bit more, we'll find ecosystems, which are systems where living things interact closely with each other and their physical environment. A biome is too large for every organism within it to interact closely. For example, the temperate forest biome in the eastern United States has many ecosystems contained within it. These ecosystems share similar qualities you'd expect from temperate forests, but they are also unique, with their own combination of resources and life that relies on them. In ecology, resources that are non-living are called abiotic factors. What do you think are some abiotic factors that are present in ecosystems? Pause the video and write down your thoughts in your guided notes. Did you come up with any good ideas? You might have said water, air, soil, sunlight, or temperature, and any of those would be correct. In this lesson, we'll be focusing on abiotic resources absolutely essential to all life, starting with water. As you might recall from one of our previous lessons, water's unique structure and special hydrogen bonds allow it to stick to itself and other polar molecules. These unique traits make water essential to life on Earth. Water helps transport nutrients. It acts as a key ingredient in cellular metabolism. It regulates temperature, and it supports the structure of DNA in living things. Water is delivered and regulated via the water cycle, which is the continuous movement of water on, above, and below the surface of the Earth. When water is heated up by the sun, it evaporates or turns from a liquid into a gas. This forms clouds in the sky, where the water vapor cools and, through condensation, becomes liquid again. From here, it is released back to the ground as precipitation, such as rain or snow, where it collects and the cycle repeats. Living things are also a part of the water cycle. Plants absorb water and release it back into the atmosphere in a process called transpiration. Additionally, water vapor is released as a byproduct of cellular respiration when living things breathe. The water cycle delivers fresh water to all living things, making it invaluable to ecosystems. Additionally, some ecosystems receive more water from the water cycle than others, which influences which types of organisms can survive there. Next up is carbon. This incredible element has a ton of flexibility with how it can bond with other elements, so it takes on many forms, from coal to diamonds to elephants. All living things are made up of carbon-based molecules, such as proteins, DNA, and carbohydrates. These molecules are essential for many of the processes that keep living things alive, such as growth, reproduction, and metabolism. The carbon cycle is the process by which carbon is continuously exchanged between living things and the environment. This cycle starts when plants use carbon dioxide from the air to produce food through photosynthesis. When organisms eat plants or other organisms that have eaten plants, some of the carbon becomes part of their bodies. When these living things die, their bodies and the carbon they contain are broken down, releasing carbon dioxide back into the air, where it can be taken up by plants again, repeating the cycle. Carbon is also released back into the atmosphere when living things breathe during the process of cellular respiration, and when carbon-based fuels are burned to create energy. The carbon cycle is essential for maintaining the balance of carbon in the environment, which is the foundation by which all life is built from. Speaking of resources that build living things, this brings us to nitrogen. Nitrogen is an important component in proteins and DNA, which are absolutely necessary for life. The nitrogen cycle is the process by which nitrogen moves through the environment, changing form and supporting life. Most plants and animals cannot use nitrogen in its natural form, so it must be transformed into ammonia or nitrates by special bacteria in the soil in a process called nitrogen fixation. Once the nitrogen is in a form that can be used by plants, it becomes part of the food chain, and when animals eat plants, the nitrogen becomes part of their bodies. When living things die, the nitrogen returns to the soil and can be transformed again, starting the cycle over. The nitrogen cycle is essential because it helps maintain the balance of nitrogen in the environment and provides the nitrogen that plants and animals need to grow and survive. And with that, we have covered the basics of abiotic or non-living factors within ecosystems. We've learned that ecosystems include all living organisms interacting closely in an area, as well as their physical environment. This includes abiotic factors such as water, carbon, and nitrogen, which are all cycled through the environment to maintain balance within ecosystems. In our next lesson, we'll dive deeper into ecosystems as we discover how living things interact to create food webs. Until then, I'm Anthony, and remember, life is full of wonders, so keep learning and don't ever stop wondering. Hey!